Guys, this is a long video. I've put a table of contents in the video description so you can jump directly to the bit that you actually want to watch. Otherwise, enjoy the whole video.
This is the unit as it stands. I just switched the car on. And this is the unit. So it's got the Agama launcher, which is what it starts up with. And this just is it has all the shortcuts to anything that I want to use. So if I want to use navigation, it goes directly to Waze, and then let's get rid of that, and Spotify.
The switch.
Yeah, so that sounds pretty good. So everything is working on this, including Bluetooth hands-free. And then when I put the car into reverse, you get the backup camera as well, so that we can see where we're parking.
So you want to install an aftermarket head unit in your Saab 9-3 from 2003 to 2006. It is possible, and it's easy enough depending on what you want to do. But you may have heard from anyone who owns a Saab of this year who has attempted this that don't do it. Yeah. But it really depends on what you want to achieve, what sort of head unit you want to have in your Saab. Because if you only want to have a single DIN unit because you want whatever features that it has incorporated within it, then it's very, very simple to install one of these into your Saab without doing any modifications as such. The only place on the dashboard itself that it will fit without any modifications is where the CD player, the stock CD player currently is. And that is a single DIN size. So you could slip the CD player out of the dashboard and you can pop in a single DIN aftermarket head unit. However, if you want to have a satellite navigation system, something with a screen in your car, there's gonna be some modification that's required, extensive modification in fact, that is required. From a wiring standpoint, this can be simple or difficult depending on the level of stock sound system that you have in your car. If you have the very basic Saab sound system, that means that you'll have the speakers in the dashboard and a couple of speakers on the muscle shelf. It's fairly easy to do because all of the wires for these speakers are already plumbed in behind the entertainment head unit in the dashboard, which is hidden behind the climate controls. And that means you can take a feed from every speaker and plumb them straight into whatever head unit that you want to have. However, if you have a better sound system in your Saab from stock, like the 7 speaker or the 13 speaker, it means that you will have additional amplifiers in your car. So if you have front speakers in your doors, which provide bass, they are powered by an amplifier, which is hidden under the passenger seat of the car. The amplifiers receive a signal via optical cable, which means that once you disconnect the stock system, that optical signal no longer exists and it cannot be utilized for any aftermarket system. So to get sound to these side speakers, you're going to need to power them by an amplifier using an analog cable, which you'll have to feed through. And the same goes for the back of the car. If you have the 13 speaker system, it means that you have an amplifier in the boot of the car on the left hand side, and they power 2 16x9 speakers in the parcel shelf. Again, phono cables will need to be run from each amplifier to the head unit so that you are supplying audio to them, and then obviously they're easy to fit because the amplifiers already exist in the front and the back of the car. So the power connectors are both there, so you don't need to worry about trying to find a 12 volt or running a 12 volt feed because they already exist. And the speakers are not powerful enough to warrant you running a thicker cable. So first things first, what spec is your car? As you can see, this car came with an ICM3 satellite navigation unit, which is going to be removed for my aftermarket unit. Obviously, I'm going to need to create a bezel so that the new unit looks and fits nicely into the vehicle. And I don't want to be cutting up a nice ICM3 unit. So I acquired an ICM1 unit
to do the modifications to. Secondly, this car comes with a Amp 1, which powers the two front door speakers shown here in red. This car also comes with Amp 2, which is shown here in the boot, which powers the two 6x9 speakers on the rear parcel shelf. Both of these amps are going to need to be replaced with an aftermarket amp. So why did I buy this ICM1 unit? Well, the fact is, yes, I needed to cut something up to make a nice bezel, like I mentioned before, but it also has a secondary use, and that is that you require an ICM unit to actually start the car. Your car will not start without an ICM unit. So we need to butcher this and remove the mainboard so that we can continue to be able to utilize our car. So take the mainboard out of the ICM unit, wrap it in insulating tape, and then I also wrapped it with a second set of parcel tape just to make sure the insulating tape stays on. And then just whack it into your dashboard, just out of the way so that it's there, but it's not in the way of anything else. And that means that we're ready to continue with our installation. So your Saab needs to have an ISO connector, so you can plug in whatever radio you want. So there's two of them, as you know. One is for power and the other one is for speakers. So we're going to start with the power side of things first. The yellow wire needs a permanent live connection. So you can get this either from the CD player or from one of the amps in the car. It's completely up to you. Once you've done that, the CD player will have power. But you also need to connect the red wire to your cigarette lighter. This is an ignition live, and it means that when you turn the ignition of the car on, the radio will turn on. And the black wire goes to the cigarette lighter as well for ground. After you've done this, the radio will be powered, and that means that that's done.
So, you're going to drag out your EHU. There we go. And then you're going to be presented with a radio loom. And I'm just going to disconnect this so that you can have a look. Right, so here's your cables. And these are the speaker cables here. The black here and the red are the power for this unit. Do not cut them. And the orange over here is your fiber optics. Do not cut that as well, because that means that you will not retain your indicator sounds. If you are just replacing the CD player here with a single DIN unit, don't cut any wires. Instead, just splice them and connect the individual speakers to the relevant wires and leave it at that. That means that you're retaining the car's original functionality and adding the CD player. But that's boring, and that's not what we're doing. What we are doing is we're putting a big screen up here. So we're cutting the wires. So we're going to cut all the speaker wires off of here. So that's five channels. That's front left, front right, rear left, rear right, and the center. But what we're going to do, and what you must do, is find the cable that goes to the center speaker and connect it to the output of the left or right speaker. Because what that means is your entertainment head unit is still going to be connected to the center speaker. And that means that all your car sounds, like your indicator noises, are all going to come out of the center speaker. And that's what you want. But it also means that you have four channels of audio, front left, front right, right, which you can connect to your new head unit. So that's how we do it. I can't actually remember which of these wires goes to which speaker. When I did it by trial and error. So the way that I did it was I set my CD player to only come out of the front right speaker, and I had it powered. And whilst it was powered, I was connecting it to these wires. And obviously, as I was doing it, the sound started coming out of whatever speaker I'd connected it to. And as soon as I found the front right speaker, which would be this one, if I knew my left and right, then it was correct. So I wired it up there. And then once that was already wired in, I set my CD player to only come out of the front left speaker. And again, I connected all the wires until I found the correct speaker that started playing audio. And then I knew that was correct. And then I did the same for the rear speaker. So that's what you're going to need to do to make sure that you've got the right speakers. But remember, the center speaker needs to remain connected to this loom, but it needs to be connected to the left or the right channel, because the center speaker itself, when stock, does not have any car sounds. You have to actually connect that up.
So using that method, connect all of the speakers to the relevant channel on your ISO connector. So at this point, if you've got the basic Saab sound system, dashboard, speakers and rear speakers, you're done. Everything is connected up as it should be. Problem is, this car has the top end sound system, which means it has amp 1 and amp 2 driving the door speakers and the 6x9s on the parcel shelf. And because these weren't working, the car was sounding pretty shit. So I was trying to avoid installing aftermarket amps in the car, so I thought I'd do a little bit of experimentation. And as you can see from this video, I went as far as directly wiring the front door speakers and the rear parcel shelf speakers directly to the front head unit instead of the dash speakers and the basic rear speakers. And this worked, and it sounded a lot better. But the problem was, the speakers were, even though they were bassier and, you know, there was more mid, all the high was lost. So all the treble was basically gone. And that was because this car uses a component system, and it requires the sound to from the dashboard to complement the door speakers. So then I tried installing the dash speakers and rear speakers and the 6x9s and the door speakers all to the head unit on the front. And the problem with this is that the smaller dash speakers overpowered, because they were getting the same voltage as the bigger speakers, they overpowered them. So I was getting less bass. So essentially it was like the other speakers weren't there, because I couldn't independently control the dash speakers from the other speakers. So the short answer is no. You cannot get away with not having an aftermarket amp. You have to have amps to power the door speakers and the 6x9s. You can either do this with two separate amps like the car has now, or you can get one 4-channel amp and use that to run both sets of speakers. Either way, you need to have the amps. So we need to put an aftermarket amp under the passenger seat where amp 1 is. To get to it, you're going to have to move the front seat. So slide it all the way forward and you will find two massive star screw bolts holding it to the runners, holding the runners to the floor of the car. So undo those two screws and you'll be able to tilt the chair forward, lift it, and then move the whole thing back. You don't need to take the car, take the chair out of the car. Just move it all the way back like I'm doing in this video. And that will give you access to the actual amp underneath the seat. This is the connector that goes into amp 1. As you can see from this image, I have cut the speaker cables and I have inputted them into some wire extensions which will go to the amp, the aftermarket amp. What you can't see in this image is that I've also cut into that red and purple wire and the black wire. They supply the power to the amplifier. And that's what's going to power our external amplifier.
I remember the old amplifier needs to be put back in place because it's going to keep the optical loop running, which means that you'll be able to keep the indicator noises and the reverse sensors, etc. But you also need to make sure that the old amp is powered. So the power and the ground wires, which are the red and the white, the red and the purple and the black wires here, need to remain connected for the original amp. But I also need to power the new amp. And because it's only powering the door speakers, I'm not going to run a new power cable from the engine bay. I'm just going to run these. So I'm going to use one of these electric blocks to basically run both amplifiers.
To get the RCAs and the remote wire for the amp to the dashboard from its current location under the passenger seat, you're going to need to take the trim off of the car. And you literally do that by getting your fingers under it and then pulling it up and remove it. You can see here that I've already ran some wires under it, which is what these loose cables are underneath the trim. But it's very easy. It just pulls off. To remove amp 2, the rear amplifier, you need two long flat pieces of metal. In my professional manner, I have used spoons because their handles are nice and long, and after you've popped them in the sides, the unit will just slip out like so. Similar story with the rear amp. The red and blue wire is the live and the black is the ground, so that's what you need to use to power your rear amplifier, your aftermarket amplifier. And these green wires are the rear left and rear right speakers. So you need to run these to your aftermarket amplifier for the back as well. And then, of course, phonos to the front of the car. So it's Dremel time. So I acquired an ICM1 from a very kind man on the 9.3 Facebook forums. And I went about cutting a single DIN hole in the face and in the rear of the plastic of this unit after removing, obviously, all of the internal bits and pieces. Then I extended the hole behind the ICM unit just a little bit so that a single DIN unit would slip in place. When it was perfect, I then palmed it off on my friend Dave, who fiberglassed it. Started building up the fiberglass so that it started to get closer to actually fitting a single DIN unit. Lots of sanding and playing around involved, then a bit of filler, then more filler, more sanding, more filler, more sanding until it got nice and flush.
Here's a preliminary video of this. It's not complete. I'm still working on it, but basically the gap behind the actual radio itself is going to be filled in with this here. This was an ICM1 radio which has been fiberglassed by this man here, and it will be painted black after it's sanded down.
So after lots more sanding and six coats of gloss paint, it became a very shiny thing, which obviously wasn't going to look very good in the dashboard. So sanding of the paint left it in this nice sort of matte grayish black. It is pretty much exactly the same as the dashboard itself. And as you can see, fits nicely in place around a single DIN unit. And it really does look the part. I mean, it's pretty much perfect. So let's talk about wiring. So I've got two amps, which means I need to have two pre-outs, which I've marked here in red, rear amp and front amp. If you don't have amps in your car, then you can get away with literally any radio. Your microphone is going to go on the pillar above the driver. The radio antenna is going to be a FACRA adapter, which comes from the EHU. The GPS antenna is going to go on top of the vents inside the dashboard. And that's about it for now.
Put the radio in now, and then pop the makeshift bezel into place. There we go. So when installing the reverse camera, what you need to do is remove this strip here from here. And you do that by removing the four bolts down here, 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 and there. If you remove all four of those, this whole section above the number plate will actually come off, and that will allow you to pop a wire sort of in between the car and this plastic when you put it back on. Now I've only screwed the camera using one single large screw, so that'll be sufficient because it's a very tight. It's all it needs. And then wiring wise, run it inside the car. You'll need to remove the inside of the boot lid, which I've got on the ground over there. It's only held on by a bunch of little plastic poppers, so it's easy to take off. Just make sure you don't lose any of them. You'll plug in the AV cable, so that's the actual video cable for the camera. That needs to go to the front of the car. And there's a separate red wire that's also on the video wire, and that's the trigger wire. And you need to loop that to the positive, to the 12 volt positive for the reverse light, as well as the red wire from the power cable. So this black and red, that is for the power for the camera. So both red wires need to go to the live for the reverse camera. And the black wire needs to go to a grounding point on the car. So the way that I've done it is I've ran the positive to the reverse camera, which is pin one, the first pin on this connector for the rear light cluster. And the ground is going down here inside the plastic sheath around the hinge of the car. And then the wire comes out here and goes to the grounding point, which is just there, and that means that it works just fine. So if I pop the car into reverse, just walk around Dave, who's currently replacing the brake pads, which are non-existent on the car at the moment. So if we pop the car into reverse, first of all, you'll see that you can see the sky because the boot is open. And then you'll be able to see that the lights are on the actual reverse camera as well, which means you've connected it correctly. There you go. Backup camera goes into the rear view, phono. And you need to connect the back wire to the live from the camera.